Hello there and welcome to the video. This time around we're going to look at the game by the London God himself, Garakowski. Garakowski was a prodigy and he was later a world championship candidate. He played the match against Karpov when the title was twisted. There was a PCA title that Kasparov held and Kamsky played against Karpov. But then he quit playing for a while, was focusing on his studies, but then he made a comeback, and especially after the comeback, he was one of the leading London players in the world. And when I started playing the London system, you know, I really looked at, you know, Garakowski's games, and there was also a player on the Internet Chess Club, the username VDoc. He was the number one player. He was playing the London system, so I started kind of playing the London system before this boom of the London system. But the London system has always been around, and it's one that, you know, seems to twist people up a little bit. Either you just completely hate it or you play it and you love it. I like to play it. I play other openings, but I think the London is a fine weapon to have in your arsenal. And especially for blitz and rapid games. And in fact, one of my best results in blitz was second place in the Icelandic Chess Championship. And then I had recently started playing in London, and it proved to be a tremendous weapon for me. So I have a strong connection with the London system. But okay, let's see the game. It's a nice attack game also by Garakowski, you know. Contrary to popular belief, the London system is not just, you know, something dry, you play the same moves and it's completely boring. You know, every opening, you know, can be boring if both players want to go that way. But let's see, d4, d5 and bishop to f4. I think the London is more effective against d4, d5. If black goes knight f6 on the first move, just gives black more options, and I think, you know, white has to pick his poison a bit more there. But on we go here, e3, c5, knight to f3, knight to c6, knight comes to d2. Saving the bishop, I like to do that as well, but apparently Kamsky is not doing it for the same reason as people are doing, you know, in modern days. This game was played about 5 years ago. Bishop g3, and castles. And one of the videos I managed to make on the London system reached exactly this position. Now, I like to play bishop b5, and that's a move that Magnus Carlsen and others have popularized, but there's nothing wrong with bishop d3. So you can, if you play the London, you can pick and choose which move you prefer. I'll link to the video I did on this particular setup for black, which I think is quite useful, and you know, it has served me well, and I even managed to score an over-the-board game victory, shortly after making the video. Although that was a while ago now. But anyway, bishop d3, and his opponent, Alexei Goganov, he played b6 here. Now, many people want to go for e5 here for black, and they play queen e7. So this is one of the better-known traps in the London system, and Garakowski, the London God, was of course one of the first to get this trap noticeably on the board against a strong opponent. He got it against Samuel Shankland at the US Championship. And white plays knight e5 to occupy the e5 square, not to allow black to break with e5. Black tries to, you know, challenge that hold on the e5 square. White now takes. And now the best move is surprisingly to take with the queen. And that's because the bishop on d7 will end up hanging. So after this forced line, d takes e5, white has this stunning resource, bishop takes h7, and this is what happened in the game between Kamsky and Shankland. And I think the point is that in some lines, white will have knight f6, and this will hang. So a move like queen b5 already, black is in big trouble after e4. Kamsky has won games like this, so a pretty well-known trap. And I think people are more or less not falling for this too much anymore. So b6 was played here, and now queen e2 by Kamsky. Bishop b7, the reason why you play b6, trying to control this e4 square. Sometimes the knight, you know, makes a maneuver, comes to f5, and sometimes with d6, and black tries to control this, but white wants to organize a quick e4 break, and he plays it here, e4. And this is, surprisingly effective. And black kind of, I think he has to play bishop e7 like he did in the game. Because if you start chopping off here on e4, I will take with a knight. And all of a sudden, it's not easy for black to find the move. We're trying to take on c5, opening up this. If you take on g3, you're just opening up the h file. And now we have problems on the h7 square. Still d takes c5. And the move like this. Again, d takes e5 is probably very strong. But bishop takes h7 also looks like it might be on the agenda here. And black probably loses because of many things. For instance, knight d8, we cannot take. What to do? You try to keep it, but I think a move like this here, and now even rook d7 is curtains. Something like this, and we're threatening bishop d6, and then queen h8, and the game is over. So taking on e4 is definitely asking for trouble. So Kokonov played bishop e7, e5 now. So white gets this nice pawn chain here in the center. Let's get them green here from top to bottom. Even though we started from the bottom, now we're here. Okay, e5, knight h5. And notice that, yeah, with this pawn chain, this bishop is looking quite nice. Before proceeding, he plays a3 because now black was thinking about takes, and knight b4. And that's a problem because we want to maintain the bishop on the diagonal, but then bishop a6, protected by the knight, would have been an issue for white. So a3, an important prophylactic move. And now black closes things up with c4. This was probably ill-advised by black. Bishop b1, g6. And knight f1. Now he starts a typical maneuver, a maneuver you often see in the King's Indian attack, where the knight travels here, from here to here, eyeing the king side. So black kind of is forced to go for a counterplay on the queen side, plays b5 and a5. The knight comes to g4 as planned, and up b4. And you notice that Kamsky does not take on b4, because that would allow the rook to become active in many lines, so he, you know, just keeps attention. He's willing to sack the a3 pawn if needed. Queen e3, black takes on c3, and now he has the option to take, but if he does, well, he comes under heavy fire. He played rook b8, but something like this, it's already very tricky after bishop h4. I think we can even land a check here now with knight here. And black is in trouble. If king here, we can take, and the knight on h5 is trapped. And if king f8, I think again g4 and queen f4, something like this, and then there's, you know, a problem on this square. So Kokonov decided to go for counterplay, rook b8, but not bishop f4. Similar to many lines in the King's Indian attack, where you have, you know, somewhat similar situation. You want to trade off this dark squared bishop because it covers a lot of squares. Bishop c8, opening the b-file. Bishop g5. Proceeding with the plan, we want to weaken these squares. Rook b3. And h4. There's no rush to trade, we can trade when we want. Queen to b6. Bishop c2. The bishop is hanging, and after rook takes a3. Now we go for it. Kamsky trades. Knight takes e7. Very logical to get the knight closer to the king. But it might already be too late. Queen to h6. The immediate threat is even knight f6. With mate on g7. Black tried knight f5. But Kamsky, he took it. E takes f5. And now knight g5. And this is a big problem because once we take this, this is hanging with mate. And black tried to utilize the pin now. Played knight f6. Now if we take with check, queen takes. And there's a pin here. But Kamsky, he found a very good move. He played knight to e3, unpinning the pawn. So now we're trying to take. but we wouldn't take immediately. Black played f4. Let's say, for instance, that, you know, black plays a move like bishop b7. White would probably castle. And, well, it's hard to find a good move for black. You still can't move this because of the mate. So let's say we, you know, just take a pawn or something. But now knight takes f5. And now there's mate on g7 also. And if you take, now my queen is protecting the pawn. And it's going to be mate or winning the queen. So 93, strong move. Gurganov answered with f4, but now another hammer blow. Knight takes d5. The knight can't take because checkmate. Black tried queen d5. Sorry, queen to d8. And can you find the final move for white? A very unusual final move to force resignation. Again, the pin. So we can't take immediately. So how do we do it? How did Kamsky force resignation? I like it. I like it a lot. He played castles. Unpinning on the 30th move. And forcing resignation. Black is just completely toast. Now we're threatening to take. Well, with a pawn or the knight, either one. And if you take on d5, attack with a pawn, mate on g7. Nothing to be done, so Gurganov resigned. So a very nice win by the London God. And yeah, a game that I like. And some inspiration for you London lovers out there. There's a lot of London hate these days. So, you know, we have to, you know, keep up the balance. Balance the force. So may the London force be with you.